like a night out with no moon. My heart has darkened, but I have hopes the sun will return soon. I wish you no ill, I give what I can, or I lay on them, so don't have empty hands. If we return, the coming spring,
I flock that. Failure is almost an assumed expectation and a notion that we accept. And because of those two aspects in schooling, where students can fail in school and proceed with their classmates who don't fail, there is the gap widens. And within that, as a student goes through a system of schooling, as that gap widens, the apathy, the attitude drops, the actions towards good work habits, positive self-esteem, you know, growing experiences decline.
Ever since I was a little kid, my mother and grandparents always told me, oh, you gotta go to college, you gotta go to college. And so it got stuck to my head, you know. I grew up and that's my mentality now. I also saw that there's a lot of poverty in my family. There's probably only like two of them that actually graduated high school.
You know, half the kids that even are college ready aren't really college ready, right? They're taking remedial courses, and then half of them are dropping out after the first year. So, you know, from a business standpoint, we're a failing model.
I believe the fact that there's so many resources and so many people that could help you, yet the students feel like they're hopeless and they can't ask any questions. They're afraid of asking questions, and that's a big factor of not getting the help that's needed.
Why is effort or attendance or, you know, other things that are not skill-based being factored into a skill and standard-based grading system, right? So we have to open that up.
And there's a lot of students now that are probably affected by it because, you know, they show up late, and I've actually been late once. It was a terrible thing. I walk in, and they make you wait in line. They tell you, they make you give them your birthday, and your name. I think your advisory, and they make you wait in line. You feel like you're being, you know, you're going to prison. So I mean, you're not going to prison, but just that little thing makes you feel sad, and you don't want to go through that. So a lot of people just don't go. You know?
We look at all aspects of the child. And our job is to break the chains of poverty, to build up a sense of worth, to connect them to a family and community school, and to provide them experiences outside of their bubble, let's say, so to speak, that open their minds to new opportunities.
I was blessed with really great teachers. I wouldn't be the student I am if I wasn't for them today.
I think they do motivate you, but not all of them put the effort to keep on pushing you. They keep saying, oh yeah, graduate high school, go to college. But I mean, that's what they're told to do. I think there should be more teachers that do hands-on training that actually care about you and tell you what you're doing wrong, because most teachers don't even tell you what you're doing wrong nowadays.
I think that the restorative justice framework allows us to connect adult to student differently than in the past. Whereas a teacher might refer the student out to be dealt with for behavioral issues, might suspend the student from class for non-compliance or defiance, who might want the student removed from their class because they're not progressing or they're not behaving in a certain way. And where restorative says, no, we have to work with that student, we have to get to know that student, we have to build from where they are at and recognize that, reward any type of progress, and have an opportunity to build relationship in a different way than just the teacher-student.
Yes, I was actually there to support the Student Bill of Rights, and I was one of the people with the megaphone.
I would have to say 8th grade, there's this class that I liked. It was called Leadership. So we would throw the events for the school. I love being involved in my community and my school. So that class, you had to have a 3.0 or no D's. And ever since that, I tried my hardest to get my best grades and to graduate on stage. So I did it for myself, that class, and my mother to, you know, make her proud.
Yes, I have seen many changes since the Student Bill of Rights passed. I've seen more people and students appreciate what was passed and take advantage of it in a good, positive way.
So for the vision of Roosevelt, being reconsolidated into one large school is really taking a step backward in time to a certain degree, right? It's great in the fact that we are consolidating the campus to have that, come back to the traditions that alumni so appreciate.
Well, Inner City Struggle, I actually joined it this year. I wish I joined earlier. I came in, they're very nice. I think they love me here. Mm-hmm. I love them too. Basically, it's, they tell you about your rights, tell you what's going around the community or what the district is doing that's wrong, and they tell you, like, this is what we can do. They help you fight for your rights, I guess, so we could get a better education.
My teachers from the cohort and from the School of Law and Government, they really encouraged me into taking other activities and programs.
I actually want to be a history teacher, so I'm going to school for social sciences.
What school are you going to?
University, UCSD.
I'm going to Pasadena City College, and I'm tagging with a program at Cal State LA. Yes, I believe I'm very ready. Maybe more of the change and the experience. Not so much in the studying, but it's getting there.
My name is Bruce Bivens. I'm principal at Roosevelt High School. It's my fourth year with Roosevelt, my first year as the main campus, Consolidated Roosevelt High School.
My name is Ramon Uribe Jr. I'm the senior at Theodore Roosevelt High School.
Hi, my name is Fatima Andrade, and I'm a senior at Roosevelt High School.